My name is Rachel Fenichel. I lead the Blockly team at Google. This talk is part of the 2022 Blockly Developer Summit. In this video, I'm going to tell you what we've been up to in the last year and what we're planning to work on in the next year. This talk has two parts. The first part looks back at the last year of work. The second part looks forward to the next year. For each part, I'll talk about features that we've built or will be building, and then look at progress on our migration to TypeScript. So, what have we been up to since the last summit? As a reminder, the last summit was April 28th and 29th, 2021. This year's summit is May 3rd and 4th, 2022. First things first, the Blockly team grew significantly in the past 6 months. In alphabetical order, here are the people who started working on Blockly this year, either full-time or part-time. First up, Aaron Dodson. Aaron is a software engineer who works on Blockly and on Google's CS First project. You've probably seen him being helpful on the forum and on GitHub. And he has had the dubious honor of managing JS Doc for the past few releases. Next is Becca Westberg. Becca has been an open source contributor for multiple years. This year she joined us at Google as a full-time software engineer. During her internship last summer, she rewrote Blockly's serialization system to make it flexible and extensible. Christopher Allen knows JavaScript from the inside out and applied his knowledge to the TypeScript migration for the past several quarters. John Munoz is a product manager at Google. This year, he became the primary point of contact for partners who use Blockly. And last but not least, Neil Fraser, Blockly's founder, returned to the team to work on both Blockly and Blockly games. So, what features did we build in core this year? Following last year's roadmap, we focused on formalizing and publishing APIs that let developers extend Blockly without forking or monkey patching. Becca designed and built a new serialization system that allows blocks to be serialized to JSON. Developers can now define custom serializers, avoiding translation from XML, and they can also add code to serialize arbitrary objects. You can define add-ons to the serialization system to save custom state. To learn more, check out Becca's summit video. Marybeth extended the tooltip API to allow developers to render arbitrary elements in tooltips. There's an example that uses this new API in the Blockly samples repository. And Monica added a positionables API that you can use to add buttons in the corners of the workspace, as well as a plugin that exercises this new API. Over on the Blockly samples repository, we also saw some solid work, especially on the plugins. Plugins implement features that are useful in the right context, but not appropriate for every use of Blockly. You can mix and match them to get just the features that you need. Building plugins is also how we test and use our APIs. Monica built a backpack plugin using the new positionables API. With this plugin, you can drag blocks into a backpack to save them, and you can share the backpack contents across multiple workspaces. You can see that in the animation here. This is useful for a logged-in user who wants to use the same blocks in multiple places. It's also really handy for a multi-user world with a shared backpack. Monica also added a content highlighting plugin that shows a bounding box of all the blocks on the workspace. This is especially useful for a large or complex workspace where the user can easily get disoriented. Finally, Abby and Marybeth built a scroll options plugin with two cool scrolling related features. First, users can scroll the workspace with the mouse wheel while dragging a block. Second, the workspace automatically scrolls when a block is dragged to the edge of the visible workspace. Next up, migration. In the second half of 2021, we started a long-awaited migration from pure ES5 to TypeScript. This was no small task. We touched every single file in core, and we made significant changes to our build system. There is another summit talk where I take a deep dive into the details of this migration, but I'll keep it really brief here. In Q3, we paused feature work, and the whole team pitched in to update every file to use Clojure modules and ES6 syntax. We released a beta version in September rather than a full release, which gave us more time for testing. In Q4, that's October to December, we finished modularization, did a lot of testing, and fixed up parts of our build pipeline to keep our outputs as close to the originals as possible. Migration work continued into the first half of 2022, although it didn't involve every member of our team. During Q1, we updated from Clojure style classes to ES6 classes. Again, this was a fairly involved process. Christopher and Aaron worked on build scripts to make sure that developing in uncompressed mode continued to work, which really tested our collective understanding of modules, module loaders, and language features in JavaScript. And then Christopher and Becca built a renaming script to help developers with upgrades. It defines standard ways to record and apply deprecations, name changes, and hopefully makes your lives a lot easier when you're updating between versions. In Q2 of 2022, we turned on the TypeScript compiler and we started converting individual files to TypeScript. This process will continue one file or a chunk of files at a time, following Microsoft's suggestions for how to convert to TypeScript. I'm aiming to finish all pieces of the externally visible conversion by the end of Q2. So, that's what we worked on in the last year. Next up is the roadmap. What we're going to do, what we're going to build in the next 12 months. Our feature work on the core library will focus on adding APIs to support plugins. We'll choose APIs based on a combination of the plugins that external developers build and the ones that we build and publish ourselves. We read everything that you post on the forum, so make sure to tell us if you're building a plugin and you get blocked by a missing API. We're still following the plan I described last year, where we define interfaces for parts of Blockly, and then we move them into the registry, and then you can hot swap for your own implementations. And the next one on the list is the trash can. Most developers interact with the core library through our releases on NPM. Currently, we release at the end of each quarter. And we follow semantic versioning conventions, so incompatible API changes means major version bumps. Backwards compatible addition of functionality, minor version bump. Backwards compatible bug fixes, patch version bumps. So you can look at those when you're looking at our versions and figure out which one is going to cause you trouble when you update. Now, I want you as developers to be confident in updating regularly. I want you to have painless upgrades, and I want the new versions to be useful enough that you really do want to update. To make that happen, I am targeting fully stabilizing core after the migration, and I'd really like to get down to 2 major releases a year instead of 4. As a stretch goal, I really want to streamline our release processes so that we can push smaller, more regular, minor and patch releases. We gave the core library a lot of love this year, so I expect next year will be quieter in core, and we'll focus more on plugins. In the second half of 2022, we'll explore how to better support users with large or complex workspaces. That could mean support for folders like App Inventor has, modal function editors like code.org, refactoring tools, and improvements for rendering and rendering performance. The correct way to organize a large workspace or multiple workspaces depends heavily on context, so these are going to be plugins rather than features in core. The plugins are also critical for the library because they force the team to use it as developers without the ability to reach inside the library and use private functions. I hope that our continuing focus on plugins pays off both directly in the plugins we publish and indirectly in the ways we improve the library. Finally, documentation. The library gets more useful when there's good documentation. In the next few quarters, we're taking a look at our documentation to fix up existing holes, particularly in user guides and code labs. As always, I invite you to get involved in writing or editing code labs, especially if you're already explaining things on the forum to other developers. We're also going to get more opinionated in our documentation, and we'll publish more guides that focus on best practices. I'm particularly interested in documenting best practices for accessibility and for block design. In the next year, I expect we'll finish up the TypeScript conversion by reaching a state where Blockly is primarily developed in TypeScript, and our type definitions are complete and are accurate. Thanks for watching this talk, and I hope to see you at the upcoming Developer Summit. If you have questions, you can post them in the Q&A or bring them to the Q&A sessions at the summit. Thanks.